morning, and welcome back. Today is Wednesday, May 12, and this is Zhangzi, Class 12, and we're in Chapter 4, which is called In the World of Men, and Burton Watson translation of the Zhangzi. Last time I read through the Chapter 4, and this time I want to do commentary and hopefully wrap it up in the hour, and then we'll go on to chapter five next week. As a matter of review, just to look over some of the chapter titles, we get a sense of what this book is all about. This is Taoist philosophy. This is guidance for the seeker. This is a statement of the way of the Taoist Zhenren or sage conducting him herself in the world. We can see the areas of discussion from the chapter titles quite nicely, and I'll just go through the first 10 or so chapter titles. Free and easy wandering, the basic way of the mind of the Taoist. Discussion on making all things equal, epistemology, the way of seeing knowledge and certainty, and not getting stuck in rigid views of right and wrong and better and worse and true and false. The equality of the many, or seeing how opposites are part of a unified system, a part of a unified whole. The unity of polarity, and deconstructing attachments we have to opinion. This three, the secret of caring for life, particularly moving towards this view of the use of the useless, and we'll see that again in chapter four, In the World of Men, which is what we're going to complete today. Five, the sign of virtue complete. What is virtue? That's the Tao Te Ching, the virtue, which is also power, which is also righteousness or rightness, greatness and rightness unified, which is very much of the sixth chakra, which is the balance of love, wisdom. And so virtue complete is approaching higher self. Six, the great venerable teacher. Seven, fit for emperors and kings, and then some kind of cute names, 8, 9, 10, webbed toes, horses' hooves, rifling trunks, and then a few more, let it be, leave it alone, heaven and earth, the way of heaven, the turning of heaven, constrained in will, mending the inborn nature, autumn floods, supreme happiness, mastering life, and another dozen or so. And, you know, Taoists are not hippies. they're very serious people. And commonly, the Taoist has done a lot of study and practice. And very significantly, relies on their own ability to make accord with fate, destiny, and life purpose. And so this is not quite the same as Buddha Dhamma from Gautama, teaching about purification of mind and freedom, liberation. Not quite the same as Advaita Vedanta philosophy of non-duality, talking about, like Nityananda, the constituents of the path, the way of the essential qualities. In some ways, Buddhism, Pali Buddhism, Buddha Dhamma, is quite exacting. The lists of kleshas and asavas, the lists of critical components for moving towards, you know, freedom out of suffering and dukkha and craving, clinging, rebirth, while Advaita Vedanta talks about the basic qualities, is a little bit more qualitative, in my view. Taoism, also qualitative, speaking from the perspective of the Zhenren. And not everything here we will agree with, in the sense that, again, this is very much a renunciate philosophy. This is not the philosophy of a world server that is happy to be martyred in the cause of social uplift or something. And so this is a particular detachment. And yet, it has absolute relevance in some ways for us in some cases, in relation to how we live our life today in the world as it is today, which is also similar to how it was at the time of Changsha, where the society was quite disrupted and there was a lot of political struggle. And you had to be real careful or you would be punished heavily by the rulership. So that's what we see with chapter 4, In the World of Men. It's basically three stories of a reformer seeking guidance in how to approach a ruler, which is applicable to us, for us, to some degree, how we might approach somebody that we wish to share with whom we wish to share our views, or where we see a problem that we feel we'd like to correct or give our opinion of, as well as dealing with our own mind to some degree, how we deal with chronic blockages and conflict or obstruction in our mind. The mind, the obstructed, the just heavily distorted mind, or an aspect of our process that's very stuck and obstructed, as a stand-in for the wayward ruler that is being given guidance by these people in this chapter, who are getting guidance in how to approach that ruler from Confucius or another character, who are literary device stand-ins for Zhuangzi and giving Taoist philosophy. So Taoist philosophy coming out of the mouth of Confucius, not historical, but literary device to offer the philosophy of how to be in the world of men, particularly working with distorted mind, others particularly, but it has application to our own. And so what I want to do is focus on what comes at the end of many of the paragraphs, which is the punchline of Taoist guidance and the Taoist advice for safely living in the world of men, or safely approaching someone who has a lot of distortion. And some people have more distortion than others. Doesn't mean they're any worse or better, but there is right view and there's wrong view, and there's no proof to any of it. By their fruits shall ye know them. In some ways, right view is right because it leads to greater well-being, or is to one's long-term welfare and benefit. What's right and good and true is what brings long-term well-being and greater freedom and greater clarity and greater stability and greater peace. And that's why it's called right and true and good. But it's quite fluid. And so today and tomorrow it may be quite different what's right and true and good for me. So this kind of fluidity is really critical also to the Taoist approach, or the Taoist value system. So the first story of Yan Hui going to Confucius, again a stand-in for Taoist guidance, talking about approaching the ruler of Wei, who's so young, who doesn't see his faults, leads his people to peril, and has harmed his nation. And Yan Hui is asking Confucius, what should I do? How should I help? How can I approach him? And so a couple of statements that explain, that get to the pith, or pith, core teaching, pith guidance, root teaching for the way of approaching such a ruler, or their way of being with such a person, or how to work with our own chronic, where we have chronic obstruction in mind, chronic blockage and confusion. So, top of page 89, this is basically on the PDF from 88 to 103, some statements that are useful. The perfect man of ancient times made sure that he had it in himself before he tried to give it to others. When you're not even sure what you've got in yourself, how do you have time to bother about what some tyrant is doing? And so the value of self-work above social reform, until one gets to a point of clarity and deep knowing or self-integration, to make sure you have it in yourself before you try to give it to others. Make sure that this is proper sequence. Make sure you know before you speak, or make sure you have some clarity in what you're saying before you speak. And that doesn't mean you have to think about it even, but there has to, it's the knowing, the sensitivity to one's own degree of knowing, and trust in rightly generated trust. We sometimes trust where we ought not, and sometimes need not think about anything, but we have some certainty and trust that our position is important or valuable, or our opinions are correct or true or valuable to be heard. There is the work, you know, so in terms of service to other, the proper sequence is to make sure you're well and clear enough, and understanding at a depth enough before you go around trying to influence others. And so that leads all different people in all different ways. Some people will take certain lifetimes to simply be outside society when they had previous lifetimes in a position of authority or leadership. And after the life came to realize they were unprepared and made a mess of it, or made trouble because they didn't know as much as they thought they knew. And then in a next life or next phase of the same life, they're withdrawn and move in greater solitude to get clear. This is very interesting. So some other statements. Virtue is destroyed by fame, and wisdom that is attention-seeking comes out of wrangling. It's not just wisdom comes from wrangling, because these are both put as low value, or put down on the lower value of the scale, this type of virtue, this type of wisdom. And the danger of pride for the server. We all have pride. Pride is one of the last kleshas to go at the end of the path, actually. And everyone who has a sense of self, or hasn't finished with the illusion of self, of separative self, has pride. Okay, so I do, you do. The only one who's free of self-interest is the one without a self, meaning the one who's free of false subjectivity. Likewise, we should be careful about thinking ourselves superior, even if our view is more accurate, even if we've done more self-work. That's not essential superiority. That's just having developed certain functions more than other people have done for themselves. And that doesn't mean I'm better, but it is a greater development of certain functions, like green, blue, indigo. but that's not a worth. So the danger of holier-than-thou attitude, or self-righteousness, or unchecked pride, and the vanity that we may have in being a server, or thinking ourselves as a server. I mean, I don't even think I'm a world server. I think that's very harmful to think of oneself that way. And the Taoist doesn't either, for sure. And so this dialogue is certainly criticizing Yanhui for any kind of pride he'll have in his approach to the ruler. And so, and he said, though your virtue may be great and your good faith unassailable. So yeah, you have, your virtue is fine, which is not the same as pride, but yeah, you have virtue. And your good faith unassailable, yes, you do want to help. You are sincere. He said, it goes on, if you do not understand men's spirits, though your fame may be wide, and you do not strive with others, meaning contend against wrong view, if you don't understand men's minds, but instead appear before a tyrant and force him to listen to sermons on benevolence and righteousness, measures and standards, this is simply using other men's bad points to parade your own excellence. Very interesting point. So, they have a very deep understanding of what excellence is, but at a very subtle understanding of its misuse. So, we may be significantly harmless, meaning intending the best for all, and happy with your happiness, and the Brahmaviharas well appreciate it, you know? Loving kindness and basic care and basic wish that all be happy and compassion for their pain and some kind of sympathetic joy, appreciation for their happiness and peaceful mind. That's not the same. That's great, but it shouldn't be paraded around. And so the Taoist is very much prioritizing save yourself or preserve your life. Don't get cut down early. Don't bring trouble into your life. Even if you know better or your virtue and learning is greater, don't get into trouble in your efforts to be of service or help. And don't get caught by some very subtle desire to be seen as superior to others. I think all of us have some of that, or when we, pride is one of the last to go, and it's very much associated with the very sense of I am me, not you and that and the outer and the, object. I'm a subject. And so the eighth fetter, conceit, or subjectivity, is only broken leaving sixth density, going out of the octave, or on from third to fourth stage of awakening. Okay, so this is something to bear in mind. Even when one has development, and one is rightly aware of other men's bad points, be careful of a subtle attachment to self-righteousness. And he said, "You will be called a plaguer of others, and he who plagues others will be plagued in return." Then, the dangers of going along to get along. Top of page 90, if you give in at the beginning, there'll be no place to stop. This is to pile fire on fire, add water to water, is called increasing the excessive. If you become more and more humble, you'll end up by supporting him. And so, parading virtue or trumpeting virtue, the principles of virtue, even if you're not calling attention to yourself, you, by doing so, calling attention to yourself, is dangerous. Likewise, uncritically, sloppily, just going along with them is also harmful. And so there's the story of rulers who utilized the scrupulous conduct of some reformers to trap them, because they were too fond of good fame. All were seekers of fame and gain. Even the sages cannot cope with men who are after fame or gain, much less a person like you. And this is, the bitter history of Confederation attempts to serve, help Earth humanity throughout the 3D cycle. The sages of the Elder Confederation, particularly 5th and 6th entity, positive groups, have a very hard time with humans who have profound web of distortions and misunderstandings in mind, and in many ways really do prefer fame and gain more than self-transformation. That's the real problem here. Most people, with their unchecked materialist worldview, i.e. YOLO, you only live once, do indeed value fame and gain above self-transformation, doing the right thing, or being right, or self-transformation, self-development. That's not where people are coming from. It's not. And how to deal with people who don't want to help themselves in the essential ways of self-help. How to help those people who don't want to do the work of essential self-helping. It's a real problem. Okay, so Yanhui goes on, and there are all sorts of other modes of service that he's talking about. Being grave and empty-hearted, diligent and of one mind. That's a sort of serious but quiet, grave and heavy of gravity and sobriety, not speaking a lot, but sort of demonstrating earnestness. And again, it's a plan, it's a plot, it's a ploy, it's a method, it's a technique. And all the techniques have shortcomings. And the fact that one is relying on technique, how to be of service, how to help, relying on memorized plans is also problematic. And so Chuang Tzu, coming through Confucius, says, you may put on a fine outward show and seem impressive, but you can't avoid having an uncertain look on your face any more than an ordinary man can. Meaning self-doubt is inevitable when one is doing a good work by the numbers in reference to one's memorized lines or methods of approach. Let me remember how to do this. And so it's got to become natural. And that's why it's a matter of what does the service is the quality of the mind. And not the technique, not even the nature of the words, but the nature of the mind that seeks to help. And so this is very subtle. And so there's even a criticism of a very useful Confucian approach called the virtue that advances a little each day, saying that while that's useful, that won't work here. Meaning it's good for you, good for us, to understand that we can little by little develop ourselves in virtue, in honesty, in clarity, in skill in service, skill in speaking. But that doesn't necessarily work as a technique in terms of changing somebody else's mind. And so I always chafe when I hear people say, counseling is about modeling, or teaching and helping is about modeling. I don't think of myself as a model of anything or for anyone. I don't think we should walk around thinking I'm a model, meaning do what I do. I know you're watching me and I want to show the right way so you can emulate me and help yourself. I think there's some arrogance to that. And it's also a technique. And so Ra's saying, you know, begin and end in the creator, not in technique. Well, that's akin to that, the nature of what that could be would be understood only by something that's given later here in the chapter called fasting of the mind. Some fasting of the mind is needed before one can have some sense of what it means to begin and end in creator, in reality, not in technique, not in method, not in prescripted notions of how to help or be. So going on, Yanhui gives all sorts of different methods of approach, and being companion of heaven, companion of men, companion of history or antiquity. And in every case, Confucius, the voice of Zhangzi, says, goodness, how could that do? And eventually he says, this is mid page 92, you have too many policies and plans, and you haven't seen what is needed. So quantity of policies and plans is a problem. And what is needed is to see what's needed. To, you know, as I always say, if you really want to help somebody, the first work is to understand them deeply. We have to understand the one we're seeking to influence, if that's what we want to do. And the greatest, but above any kind of intention to help this person, is a free sharing of what I is, or free sharing of, like Ross said, one's own understanding of the Law of One. Freely sharing what you know to be true and important. So not only true, but also important or relevant, and also in proper measure. And so being the greatest server is the greatest developed mind or being or awareness that is really balanced and really settled and really peaceful and also quite capable. And that doesn't, the great work is not, the helping work, let's say, is not done by following policies and plans, but it surely must include knowing the mind of others well. So, and in terms of following policies and plans, the criticism here is you're still making the mind your teacher. The mind that is still complex and not purified, the mind that doesn't know equanimity, the mind that at a certain level is still out of kilter with itself, which is not well settled like the bright sky, like Chittakash or Hridayakash, the heart sky, mind sky, clarity, the clear skies of mind, greater freedom. That's not what he means by that's not the, it's making plans and strategy and technique and logical analysis process and result one's teacher, rather than the true nature of mind or the equanimity. There's following the clouds and dwelling in the sky. Following the clouds, we get blown about. And the forms are ever changing and growing and diminishing. That's called birth and death. But the sky doesn't have birth and death, or the container of mind, the awareness field, the field of awareness, right? Chittakash. is not of that same birth-death process like the clouds that grow and vanish. And that's what he's saying. So Confucius says you must fast, and he says fasting of the mind. What is fasting of the mind? And this is top page 93. Confucius said, or Zhangzi had Confucius say, make your will one. Don't listen with your ears, listen with your mind. No, don't listen with your mind. Listen with your spirit. above the mind. Listening stops with the ears, but the mind stops with recognition. But spirit is empty and waits for all things. So listening stops with the ears, body. The mind stops with recognition, stops with the pause, a cessation of thinking. So a cessation of thinking is fine, but the mind operates by way of forming thoughts and clouds in the sky. But, versus those two, spirit is empty and waits for all things. And he says, and then there's two critical, the first of two critical statements or teachings that are closer to the summit of the greater work here. The Tao gathers in emptiness alone. Emptiness is the fasting of the mind. So fasting of the mind equals living, surrendering the mind to the spirit, surrendering the manasik to the buddhi, surrendering thought form production analysis to a seeing and knowing and being that is of emptiness as much as we can understand what that means. So this phrase, the Tao gathers in emptiness alone. Emptiness is the fasting of the mind. And it explains that further at the bottom of 93. Fortune and blessing gather where there is stillness. But if you don't keep still, this is called sitting but racing around, meaning body sitting, mind racing. So fortune and blessing gather where there's stillness. And the way the Tao or six chakra activation occurs with a still mind. And that's what Ra talks about, silence of mind in a steady state, as the prerequisite for doing work on mind. It's the work on mind done by higher mind, or the work on mind done by a spirit-led process. Spirit meaning of six chakra, or of the Atman, or of that which is of the sky of mind, not the contents of mind, the way of buddhi. So the Tao gathers in emptiness alone. Emptiness is the fasting of the mind. This is associated with stillness, quiet mind, equanimity. And there's just no way to get that consistently for most of us without training and practice, meaning meditation. And so some form of concentration by study, by action, you know, these are the yogas, right? Karma yoga, developing concentration and clarity of mind by way of service and action or work, physical work. Hatha is the asanas, you know, hatha yoga, the postures, the raja yoga by meditation strictly, jnana yoga. Jnana yoga is sometimes called by study or by mental work. Like certain very high-end scientists have a brilliant, you know, they have a great, powerful mind. I mean, way above mine in terms of IQ and mental function. And they've got there by dedication to intensive study that requires a lot of discipline and concentration. So that's very useful if one doesn't get stuck in the mind. Training the mind without getting stuck in the mind. So this phrase bears reflection. The Tao gathers in emptiness alone. Emptiness is the fasting of the mind. Fortune and blessing, so good karma and grace, gather where there is stillness. So after that, there's another story of another reformer going to Confucius and asking for guidance. And there's a phrase at the bottom of 94, to suffer no harm whether or not you succeed. Only the man who has virtue, can do that. And so there is success and failure. The key, one of these key Taoist virtues or principles is to suffer no harm. And so I think that's pretty reasonable. We don't want to hurt ourselves in our good works or our activity in the world. So this is putting harmlessness, doing no harm to other, and having and opening to not opening to harm from the other or to oneself, not harming other and not having oneself harmed, above success is more important than success in the Taoist value system here. This is very important. And so Confucius said, and this is middle May, page 95, in the world there are two great decrees. One is fate, the other is duty. Duty also means righteousness, and fate is sort of what we're born into, which is, you know, commonly pre-programmed catalyst, but it's programmed not by this conscious mind, but by soul or before the incarnation with the greater awareness. The other is duty, like danda or dharma. Do your dharma, do your responsibility, and accord your life with your fate. This is the point. Recognize, fulfill rightful responsibilities. That doesn't, that, you know, that's not a rigid demand either, because if there's a door, then there's a way out. And we just have to consider the costs of walking out the door. It's allowable. Are we willing to pay the cost? Sometimes we ought to, and sometimes we ought not. So that's associated with duty. But according one's life with one's fate and fulfilling righteous or rightful responsibility is, I think, what we're talking about here. And it says that a son should love his parents is fate, that a subject should serve his ruler is duty, and filial piety for, you know, family relations. And in Buddhism too, as I said, taking good care of one's parents or being a good child to one's parents is valued as, is considered part of one's dharma or duty as well. And so the obligations associated with one's fate are a portion of one's duty. So that's for sure. But, you know, depends on the parents and the relationship and all sorts of things. He also, in terms of loyalty, duty, fate, accord with destiny, in the middle of 95 is also this phrase, and to serve your own mind so that sadness or joy does not sway or move it, to understand what you can do nothing about, and to be content with it as with fate, this is the perfection of the virtue. So rightful service and rightful, you know, obligation fulfillment, but to take care of oneself deeply well too, to not get stuck in sorrow or elation, you know. And this is just, it's just the way the 3D mind operates, that a very, very precise statement is not the line of least resistance. Generalization is the line of least resistance. Simplification, oversimplification is just the default mode here of this mind. What's the cause? Why am I this way? It's what? Presumed to be one reason, not a whole constellation of causal factors. This saying, so that sadness or joy doesn't sway or move it. Well, the only way to be free of sadness and joy not swaying the mind is where the roots are dissolved. But until that time, we will still be swayed by, you know, distortions of mind, emotional charge, right? For the fully balanced entity, no situation would have emotional charge, but would be a situation like any other in which an entity could observe an opportunity to be of service. So, okay. The great purified one is no longer triggered to emotional charge. But before that happens, well, we will be. And to say we should make my own mind so that sadness and joy, meaning elation and mirth and sorrow and self-pity, don't sway or move it, is impossible. It's impossible until the roots are dissolved, and the roots won't even be dissolved until way, way far on the path. Actually, you have to be really free of grasping and aversion, or free of desire in a very big way, to be free of elation and sorrow. To not be, to become untriggerable, takes a long, long time, or you have to be really dedicated. And so the line of least resistance is to speak of this in a very simplistic way, and then for people to take this generalization and in a certain sense, erroneous presentation, that we should stop what? I have to make my mind so that I have no more sadness and joy. You don't sway it. But every time it arises, I'm swayed. And it won't stop arising until there's a profound freedom from desire, meaning attachment to this and that, or longing. So it's not going to work if I try to stop it from swaying me. I'll just do suppression. I'll do harm to my own mind. So that's a lot more accurate a perspective than just saying, make sure it doesn't sway your mind. Stop, just stop. That's not the way. That's suppression. That's trying to overcome. That leads to all sorts of trouble. But that's the way that it's normally spoken. Don't be swayed. Well, the result, and Ra had said that it's much more the case that we can be aware of when they come and meet the emotional charge with understanding and acceptance and forgiveness and all that. That's the healing cycle. It's going to happen a long time, for a long time, that we have to meet the emotional charge that sways us with love, acceptance, kindness, understanding, forgiveness, long, for a long, long time before we get to the point where it just doesn't arise. The emotional charge just doesn't happen. That takes a lot more work, as Ra said. And so people should be more careful in how we seek to, what guidance we use to work with our own mind. Going on. mid-page 96, in terms of speaking and communication, the guidance is, transmit the established facts. Do not transmit words of exaggeration. If you do that, you'll probably come out all right. Probably. So be careful in speaking and saying, what was simple in the beginning acquires monstrous proportions in the end. Sometimes that happens, yeah. And so, like when men meet at some ceremony to drink, they start off in an orderly manner, but usually end up in disorder. And so what is a good beginning is not as good as a good end. And so very careful in terms of an understanding of the sequence of events, event sequences. And that's very sophisticated. And the Taoist has a very, very, I think, a very sophisticated understanding, like the Book of Changes, right? The I Ching. Which is a classic as much as Tao Te Ching or Zhuangzi. And deep in the mind of the Taoist is an awareness that all things must pass, present moment phenomena is a snapshot of eternal flux, of phenomena in a constant change and morphing process. So to get to the middle of stretch to the extreme. That which is stretched to the extreme will come back to the middle. So like when I'm riding on the bike and I see a red light in the distance, I'm happy because I know that by the time I get there, it'll probably turn green. While if I see a green light in the distance, I'm not so happy because I have a sense that it'll probably be red by the time I get there. Something like that. And so the harsher the winter, the sweeter the fruit. Rich summer comes from a harsh winter. Recently, I've had many a few monkey visits. Today was unusual. Yesterday, 2 days ago, I had a monkey troop, some younguns, and they have they're about 1 or 2 feet tall, and they are eating a certain kind of leaf next to on a tree by my room. And their coat, their fur was very rich, black, dark brown, dark gray, dark brown, black, because of the cold winter. But there was a whole bunch of them, six of them, juveniles, and they all seemed to be in a good mood and quite active. And today I had a visit from one, which is very unusual to have one who, this was a courtesy call. And like 5 in the morning, I hear some heavy weight on my roof, and I know who it is. And then I came out, and I see a paw hanging over the ledge, over the rail, over the roof. And then he knew I was there, and he scurried back. But their well-being today is partly the result of the long, cold winter here too. And so, the Taoist is very aware that. If that we are the present moment is a snapshot of an ever-changing phenomenal display, and therefore they can have patience naturally. And we have become very impatient with modern culture. We want, fast, quick, easy, cheap, fun, and some things are, and that's great. But most whatever is really valuable, any great work takes a great effort and time to fulfillment. So, further guidance, page 97. Therefore, Confucian saying, therefore the aphorism says, do not deviate from your orders, do not press for completion. To go beyond the limit is excess. To deviate from orders or press for completion is a dangerous thing. A good completion takes a long time. A bad completion cannot be changed later. Can you afford to be careless? Just go along with things and let your mind move freely. Resign yourself to what cannot be avoided and nourish what is within you. This is best. What more do you have to do to fulfill your mission? Nothing is as good as following orders or obeying fate. That's how difficult it is. And so that is pith, Taoist teaching. To the extent that a hippie does that, then yeah, that's a Taoist hippie. Go along with things, let your mind move freely. But there's also the statement, nothing is as good as following orders, obeying fate. Resign yourself to what can't be avoided, nourish what is within you. So effort is applied to self-care. Don't get involved in activity that is harming to self. Don't do self-harm. Right? That's kind of simple. And some things in life, like fate or destiny or duty, can't be avoided, shouldn't be avoided, should be fulfilled rightly. Yeah, right. Do your danda. So Nityananda talking about vairagya and dharma. Right. Rightful renunciation, detachment, and rightful fulfillment of obligation. Yeah. And if one wants a more free and easy wandering, one should fulfill obligations and not acquire new ones. And be more or less like the rhinoceros, actually, And so the more you want from others, the more others will want from you. The more you're involved in getting from others, the more you'll be involved in others trying to get from you. Yeah, that's okay. That's relationship. And there are benefits and disadvantages. And there are benefits and disadvantages to wandering alone like a rhinoceros, kagavisana, too. And so, but the Taoist is not a stupid hippie. The Taoist is a very clear-minded reflector of life process and seeker of wisdom. And this notion, don't deviate from your orders, don't press for completion. To go beyond the limit is excess. To deviate from orders or press for completion is dangerous. So, this is not the garbage dropping hippie at Woodstock. This is a person who is very careful. The Taoist is very careful. They're not sloppy. So, going on, there was another story. This goes on and on, right? Yan He consulting Zhu Boyu, and also give some guidance. Let's see. Yeah, and the guidance was very much about being careful. You know, that's a critical matter here. The way, excuse me, the way of not doing harm to self or other requires care, carefulness. So taking care of yourself means being careful. Being careful doesn't mean being stuck in fearful. Being fearful is harmful. Being careful is essential. And so when fear arises, it may be a useful indicator that there is threat in the environment and we need to be careful or more careful. There is difficulty and there is not difficulty, right? Like Butcher Ting, when he finds a very complicated piece of meat or joint or something to cut through, he becomes more careful and slows down and does it carefully, more carefully. Meanwhile, one doesn't have to be, there's over-careful, and that's obstructive. And so, don't be careless, and the line here is 99, can you afford to be careless? So there's a price for carelessness, and sometimes it's fun to be careless, and there may be a price, and it ought to be, we ought to get some sense of what's the price of carelessness, because sometimes it's high and sometimes it's not. So this is a Taoist. The Taoist is not a dope. They are careful and thoughtful, but seek free and easy wandering and are happy to help, but they don't want to help at the expense of self-harm. Or paying the price of self-harm. When self-harm is the price to be paid, they probably will withdraw. But then it depends on one's being, right? Nityananda gave his whole life, it seemed, to fulfilling requests of thousands and thousands of desirous people. But that was not a life of self-harm. But he won't be doing that again anytime soon. Uh-huh. So that's also a matter. What could be done for 60 years or 50, 40 years may seem extreme, and there may seem to be a high cost, but it occurs within the context of multi-incarnational existence or multi-incarnationality. And so from the perspective of 1,000 years, 90 years of a certain lifetime experience is not excessive. So there's all sorts of stuff going on here. Then the final portion of this chapter is the use of the useless. How what we commonly call useless is only called useless because we have a limited perspective about use regarding value. And so talking about Carpenter Shi and the crooked shaft, a place where there's this big oak that's huge, and so beautiful, and the carpenter wanting to, thinking that he should do something with it, but the carpenter saying, it's so great and huge and has lived so long because it's worthless to men to cut it down because of the nature of the wood. And then the carpenter goes home and has a dream. And in the dream, the oak tree appears to him and speaks, saying that of the other trees that get torn apart and broken and cut into wood and this and that, he says, their utility makes life miserable for them. They don't get to finish out the years heaven gave them, but are cut off mid-journey. They bring it on themselves, the pulling and tearing of the common mob. And it's the same way with all other things. And again, one can criticize the Taoist as being overly renunciate. Meanwhile, there is a great value to do no harm to yourself. Have no harm, do no harm, have no harm to oneself. On the other hand, you know, there's a great value to selfless service and martyrdom for those moving from third to fourth density, or in certain cases in one's life, or in certain lifetimes. And the tree explains his philosophy and says, as for me, this is top page 101 or something. As for me, I've been trying a long time to be of no use. And though I almost died, I've finally got it. This is of great use to me. It's of great use to him to be of no use to them. If I had been of some use to others, would I ever have grown this large? Moreover, you and I are both of us things. What's the point of this things condemning things? You, a worthless man about to die, how do you know I'm a worthless tree? So the point is that even when the human world considers it useless, it's not worthless. Uh-huh. The worth of the useless, the value of the useless, the value of what human society doesn't value. Now, human society doesn't value some things that we would rightly not value too. There are all sorts of weird things or unpleasant things or harmful things or disgusting things that are not socially valued that we don't value as well. Meanwhile, there are also qualities of person or activities or ways of being or ways of living that society devalues, doesn't value, finds totally useless, that may be greatly worthy and valuable and even critical. So society doesn't value vairagya, but it's essential. Society doesn't value shraddha, faith, in greater reality, not in fantasy and hope, but in the metaphysical, right? The metaphysical and the physical inseparable. That truth, that sat, society doesn't value, but it's quite worthy. And so the worth of the useless, the socially useless, potentially highly worthy. So how do you know I'm a worthless tree while I have no use? My uselessness is no indication of worthlessness. The worth of the useless and the value of the devalued in some cases. And so just because someone devalues it, just because 10 out of 10 people disagree with you or think you're crazy, doesn't mean you are. Just because 10 out of 10 people think it is not so, doesn't mean it is not so. It may be, it may not be. So don't overvalue social opinion. And don't get stuck in the confines of social opinion. Everyone may call it shit, but you may know it isn't. And then you need to stand alone. And that's also kagavisana in daily life. There are people who know more than us, and there are people who are comparable, and there are those who know less and are thoughtless. Well, I have a big spider out my room also. It's a very the cold winter makes the survivors hardy in the springtime. I got some big spider. This morning I saw a Asian longhorn beetle, also called, he was polka dotted. You can look this up. The Asian longhorn beetle, also called the starry sky beetle. Only Chinese would think so poetically. The starry sky beetle is about 2 inches long, black, shiny carapace or shell with white dots, like a starry sky. So I saw the starry sky beetle and a big spider and even a personal visit from a monkey. So things are moving right along here. So the result of it's the continuance or the consequence of a long, cold, chilly, wet winter. Anyway, I want to wrap up in a couple of minutes here. If you try to judge it by conventional standards, you'll be way off. So be careful of conventional standards. It is this unusableness that the holy man, the Zhenren, makes use of. So it turns out to be a completely unusable tree, and so it's been able to grow this big. Aha! It is this unusableness that the Zhenren makes use of. So that's an important matter. What does that mean, the unusableness that the sage, that Zhenren, makes good use of? That's very useful to consider the nature of what's called useless and the value, spiritual value, self-developmental value, personal quality of life value of what social norms call useless. And so that's the final. And that's the final phrase or sentence in this chapter. But before that, in this little story, page 103, Confucius visiting Chu, the madman, the local madman named Jie Yu, screams, "Phoenix, Phoenix," which is feng, like fenglin, feng. Feng, feng, not wind, but feng, feng. How has virtue, how has de failed? The future you cannot wait for, the past you cannot pursue. When the world has Tao, the sage succeeds. When the world is without Tao, the sage, the Dunren, survives. In times like the present, we do well to escape penalty. Good fortune is as light as a feather, but nobody knows how to pick it up. Misfortune is as heavy as the earth, but nobody knows how to stay out of its way. Leave off this teaching man virtue. Dangerous, dangerous to mark off the ground and run. Fool, fool, don't spoil my walking. I walk a crooked way. Don't step on my feet. The mountain trees do themselves harm. The grease in the torch burns itself up. The cinnamon can be eaten, and so it gets cut down. The lacquer tree can be used, and so it gets hacked apart. All men know the use of the useful, but nobody knows the use of the useless. So, with that, we'll end the study for today. This is Taoism, and it's not the same as hippiedom. And I think it's lovely stuff. So, lots of food for thought. Next time, chapter 5, called The Sign of Virtue Complete. Virtue again about the. So I hope this was useful. And it's lovely. It's a lovely translation from Burton Watson. So in any case, that's it. We leave it as it is. And I hope it's been helpful for you. I hope this socially useless is quite useful personally, spiritually. So take good care of yourselves. See you next time, and good night.